really cheerful observation that we never have enough resources. I just play with the name thing for a moment. When I travel outside the UK, particularly in the continental Europe, I sometimes get introduced as Martin Knapp, which I also find easier when I check into hotels. They find me in the computer quicker. But Knapp in Germanic languages means scarce, among other things. So I was born to be an economist. The point is that there are never, this is nothing to do with austerity or George Osborne's budget or anything else, there will never have been, there never will be enough resources to meet all needs or to satisfy all preferences and wants. So we're always in a situation of scarcity. When we're in that situation, we have to make careful choices. We have to make choices and hopefully carefully. And we have to do things like rationing, which were the politicians don't like to use, prioritising, some way of choosing how we're going to squeeze out of those resources the best outcomes we can, the best results we can. So consequently, any new service or intervention, any new strategy in this area or any other area, we looked at very carefully. And the sort of questions we had asked is, okay, is that service effective? So if Declan develops and colleagues develop a new intervention in the area, is that effective? The evidence may be looking pretty promising, but a long way to go. But after that question of effectiveness, it will then be, so is it affordable and is it cost effective? And I want to just get to what we mean by cost effectiveness and then show how we might be beginning to look at it and what we're doing in that respect. And at the bottom I put, just in case the point is not there, it's an absolutely rhetorical question from my point of view. I cannot understand any circumstance in which a decision maker who's responsible for allocating resources would not want to know the economic implications. If they don't want to know the economic implications, they shouldn't be in the job. So it has to be part of the decision making. They can ignore them, but they need to look at them first of all and consider them. So what kind of economic evidence will help those decision makers who are facing this problem of scarcity? I'm going to put up five types of evidence and quickly say what they're called and what we know about them, okay, what information we've got. So one is, and this is what I've done quite a lot of work, it's trying to calculate the overall cost of autism. And if I forget to say it later on, studies like this can get quite a lot of media attention, but ultimately they're useless. Okay, so I've done lots of them, I will do more of them in the future. They're not very helpful, except for grabbing attention. Okay, they don't help the decision maker to say, I'm going to use my resources in this way rather than that way. Because they're just saying, this is the overall economic impact of a condition such as autism. Secondly, we could look at the intervention and say, what does it cost and what is the alternative? What is the alternative cost? The alternative might be doing nothing. Okay, but if we've got two or more interventions, what are the relative costs of those? The third one will be, so what does it cost for that intervention, and do we save something? Which is the question that any decision maker in this country at least will be asking today. If somebody comes along with a new idea for a service, they're going to say, fine, looks expensive, but if it's going to save at least what it costs, we might be interested in doing it. Fourthly then, what's the link between the costs and the outcomes? And now I'm beginning to get more excited. Because Knapp means scarce, and scarcity is what economists do, but those top three bullets are what accountants do. And I'm not an accountant. Accountants are lovely people, but I didn't ever want to be one. I wanted to be an economist. An economist weighs up not just the costs, but the costs with the outcomes. And that's where we're getting to something a bit more interesting. And then the fifth one would be, how can we use economic incentives to change what people do? And if I just keep that slide there, I can say if you go down from top to the bottom, things get more useful and more complicated. And I can also just show you quickly what we would call these different studies, because you may become more familiar with these, you may be exposed to more of these as the evidence begins to build up in the autism area. So these are so-called cost of illness studies or cost impact studies. I'll show you one in a moment. But these studies have budget impact, studies that cost offset, much do we save. And then we get to the really meaty stuff, the really interesting stuff, which is cost effectiveness. And I'll explain what that means in a moment. And at the bottom, what's getting really popular? We have a new MSc at my department at LSE, and behavioral science. We get more applications for that MSc than any other we've had in the past. We had a job hire, going through that at the moment. We had 130 applicants for a relatively junior job, whereas normally you expect about 30. This is a big area. How do we change people's behaviour? How do we nudge them? How do we encourage them, cajole them into changing their behaviour? As you probably know, the government here did have something called a nudge unit at number 10 to look So that's what the evidence looks like when it's given its labels. Let me show you what cost effectiveness looks like and also show you my standard student slide. So the outcome question is, does this intervention work? The economic question is it worth it? Those four words are fundamental to economic evaluation. Is it worth it? Okay, let me explain what that means. So by works, we mean it achieves its aims, it has good outcomes, it's good in terms of improving health, or functioning, or quality of life, those sorts of things. By worth it, we mean that the cost we have to pay to achieve those outcomes is considered to be justifiable. And I'll explain what that means by considering in a moment, in a couple of slides from now. So we need to know, if we're thinking about this evidence, what are the costs of doing something compared to something else? What are the outcomes for two or more things? That's what the evidence is all about. So let me show you. This is the standard student slide. It's a quadrant diagram, and it shows you on the vertical the difference in costs between two things. So two is Declan's new intervention, and one is what's happening at the moment. And it says, if you go up to the top, the costs of Declan's new intervention are more greater than the costs of what we do now. And as you go down the bottom, the new intervention is lower cost. And on the horizontal, it says if you go to the right, the new intervention is more effective than the current one. On the left, the new intervention is less effective than the current one. So I can put onto that picture, if I did an evaluation of these two treatments, I could put into that slide what the result is. And the result, if it's up in that quadrant, it says new service is less effective, it's a wonderful new treatment, it's going to be worse for your patients or the people you support, and it's going to cost you more money. You'll be out that door before you have the first sip of coffee, okay? There's no interest in that. It's just not effective, it's not affordable, not cost effective in any way. Down the bottom here, it's quite the opposite. The new service is more effective and it's going to save money, so why wouldn't you be interested in exploring that as an option? I'm not saying you have to do it, but it looks pretty attractive from an economic point of view. Now we get down here and it gets more tricky. The new service is less effective but less costly. So it's not quite so good for the people we're supporting, but it's going to save money. Now, is that cost effective? Okay, one lady who shook her head then nodded, so that's exactly. Okay, so it might not be, might mean, so when you say for some, it could be for some people, do you mean?
Yeah.
Okay, so it may be, we would expect there will be considerable variation within any population of people, any group of people, so some people might do well, some people don't. We definitely need to take into account. Why else might, the reason why it might be cost effective, let me just put that little, if that's our result of our study, that says this new intervention is only slightly less effective than what we do at the moment, but it's going to save shed loads of money. Shed loads of money is not a very technical term, but it's going to save a lot of money. So then you might say, well, actually, we could take all those savings and reuse them for supporting other people. So it might be, from a societal point of view, that is a good thing to do. It is cost effective. I'm not saying it is, it might be considered to be. And over here, now we've got the result of the study says this new treatment, this new intervention, is way less effective than what we do at the moment, and it doesn't save much money. So that's not likely to be very attractive. But you can see now we're into this world of is it worth it? It's the first two quadrants, the things I showed you to begin, those are easy because the costs and the outcomes, if you like, go in the same direction. Service one is best in the top left corner, service two is best in the bottom right corner. When we're down here, we're in this situation where we're not quite sure which is better. And exactly the same will apply over there, where the new service is more effective but also more costly, and that point Y might look pretty attractive because the effectiveness is much, much better than what we're doing at the moment, and it's not costing us much more to achieve it. Whereas that point Z doesn't look very attractive. Now, what economic evaluation is doing is taking all those sort of facial mannerisms and shrugs and everything else I had about might be, might not be cost effective, and turning it into something slightly more scientific by trying to understand how much the decision maker is willing to pay. And that's what NICE does. National Institute for Care and Health and Care Excellence does exactly that. It particularly is focused on that top right quadrant, because that's where most studies seem to find themselves today. I've got this wonderful new drug, it costs more money, but it's also going to be more effective than what we're doing at the moment. They have to decide what they do. They go through a whole series, there's a whole lot of processes they go through. The penultimate process is they produce their report and publish it. And the final point, the final stage in the NICE process happens the next day when the Daily Mail slags them off on the front page. The Daily Mail then says, NICE condemns women to early death, breast cancer, or whatever it may be, because NICE have taken the view that it's not worth it to recommend a particular treatment. Okay? But it's the point is, it is a judgment. It is not a clear black or white, you know, red or blue decision. It's a judgment. So the decision following from the evaluation is now a lot less clear, and it has to be. That's the nature of the game in this area. So, six things to remember about cost effectiveness, and then quickly I'm going to show you some evidence. Firstly, there are three essential elements: cost, outcomes, and comparison. The results, and hence the conclusions drawn, may be affected by how widely you measure the cost and outcomes. I haven't told you, showed you that, and the choice of the comparator. And then the important point four: to be cost effective, an intervention does not have to be cost saving. Something that's more expensive than what we do at the moment could well be a great thing to do, because the effectiveness is so much better than what we're achieving at the moment. And the key question then is it worth it? To which the very short answer is, it depends. Okay, and if I was many decades younger than I am now, it would be whatever. Okay, but it's a judgment. Okay, that's the important thing I want to get through. It is a judgment, it's not a clear binary yes or no. So, what do we know in the area? I showed you this slide before. There are, I think, three studies I'm aware of, which I've been involved in all three of them, looking at the overall cost of autism in the UK, and there's one more anyway in Scotland at the moment. When we look at the more evaluative studies, including cost effectiveness, I put there surprisingly, if you must, not surprising, but there are few completed economic studies. I'll show you one or two we're doing at the moment. And I found nothing in this sort of natural behavioural area that might be relevant in this area. I mean, I think lots of relevance, but not being tested or examined. So, a couple of results. This is one of those cost studies. I said they're great for having attention, great for having media reports, but not very helpful to decision makers. This is a study published last year in Pediatrics, which looked at the cost of autism in the UK and the cost in the US. We put both in the same paper. So first of all, we estimated prevalence in various ways, and then we were able to estimate the costs. And we broke the population of people with autism down into those with and without intellectual disability, not the most nuanced of classifications, but the best we could do with available data. And we broke them down by age group, depending on basically administrative boundaries. And you get a lot of numbers. I'm not going to get through the numbers that I can show you now. You know, you get estimates, for example, of lifetime costs. Put some up there for both those for the UK and lifetime costs for the US. Surprisingly similar, actually, across the two countries, for no obvious reason, I think, but surprisingly similar. But I put here, no distinction is being made between good costs and bad costs. Now, if you, well, don't do it now, but if you Google good costs and bad costs, I hope you don't find anything apart from any slides by me, because it's my idea, but it has absolutely no theoretical grounding whatsoever. But I think, when we think about costs, when decision makers think about costs, they usually think them in a negative way. They want to reduce costs, because they want to get more bang for their buck, more impact from their resources. But actually, a lot of costs are good costs. Because if somebody who wasn't previously using a service to which they're entitled, or that's going to help them, now gets a service, that's going to cost more, but most of us would think of that as a good thing. So cost is not necessarily negative. And the figures I've shown you on the slide just lump all those good costs and bad costs together. Some are absolutely appropriate responses to people's needs. Some are crisis services or things that happen because we don't identify those needs or respond to preferences early enough. So there's a difficulty in aggregating these. skip that slide in the interest of time. What do we know about other studies? I found three, I think, economic evaluations, might be others. It's not a comprehensive review, we're doing some more reviewing now in a study I'll talk about in a minute. So there are some studies beginning to come along, and I'll show you two slides here. So let me just say, firstly, in your pack, you haven't got that slide, and you haven't got the next two slides. Apologies, I didn't get them finished in time for the copying, but happy to send these if you want this information. So some studies that are currently underway. One, led by Henry Simonoff, Declan's involved in the study as well, is going back to the Knapp cohort, which Emily and Gillian Baird and others have been studying for a while. A cohort of people in Southeast England, first of all, interviewed and data collected for them ages 11 and 12, again at 15 and 16, and now they have adults, and we are collecting, I wasn't involved before, I'm now involved in the study, and we're collecting a range of information to look at a number of things, and I can then begin to look at some of the resource consequences of their needs and characteristics and preferences, and how those link to some of the quality of life and other outcomes that they enjoy or don't enjoy. And there's another study led by Emily, and again involving Declan, is an NIHR program grant, now abbreviated to IM Health, which is looking at those mental health issues that Declan mentioned in the start of his presentation. So not looking at the core symptoms of autism, should we say, but looking at more those mental health issues. And again, there's an economic element in that. So in two or three years when that's finished, we'll have much more evidence than we do today about some of the economic associations with those characteristics. There's a NAP project in a minute. And then three others. One is a study led by Tom Mackay in Scotland, not my title, the Scottish Microsegmentation Project, which was to segment the spectrum as much as possible. Much as possible meant we went from 2 to 3 segments actually, so it was much more micro-segmented. But it's included, study included an online survey which a large number of people completed, people who are interested in the autism area, a lot of family members, a lot of autistic people completed the online survey, and we're now, as part of it, and we're using that to understand some of the patterns of service use and costs. The study, a European study, which I'm involved with in a small way, which is trying to describe across European countries what's going on. And then the study with Lucy Stottard, who's here, led by Brian Beresford at York, which is looking at specialist autism teams. Now, all of those studies have many elements beyond the economic, but it's great there's an economic element embedded in them, because then we'll begin to be able to answer some of those questions about resource use. So the NAP project stands for National Autism Project. Not anything to do with my name. I would have changed the name if I could have done, but it wasn't my choice. What is it trying to do? Our bit of it, which is a big chunk of it, is trying to examine what is the economic case for a range of interventions in the area. Now, we're not collecting new data, we're not doing randomised trials or anything, we have no time to do that. We started March this year, we finished August next year, so it's a very short study. What we're doing is reviewing evidence on effectiveness, and Richard's been fantastically helpful already, Richard's research autism has generally been very helpful. Summarise what we can on cost effectiveness, there isn't very much, and then conduct new analyses. And sometimes you can take data from effectiveness studies and work out what the economic consequences would be. So we're trying to do that as much as we can. As I say, it's an 18-month project, not a lot you can do in 18 months, but we're hoping to just do this lighter weight economic evaluation to get some information out there to help decision makers, particularly local commissioners. So what do we mean by an economic case? Well, we're interested in the impact on spending. We're interested in the impact on resources of individuals, autistic people, families, communities. We're interested in a link between resources and outcomes, and therefore we're interested in the question of, is it worth it? So a range of things we're doing. I'm not going into detail, happy to come back to that in questions if anybody's interested. And then in generating new evidence, let me just put this up once actually. What we're doing is then taking the evidence from other studies. So for example, there's the Early Start Denver model, the SDM project, where they didn't do a cost effectiveness analysis, but actually they collected the data which would allow us to do it. So we're now doing a cost effectiveness analysis with their trial data. We've got other cases where we're just using data from published papers to do some simulation modelling. we're going to be talking to experts who might help us to understand what the economic consequences will be. So it's a very untidy, it's not very well, it's scientific in its own way, but it's a very untidy set of approaches trying to bring some economic evidence into the debate to help decision makers. And our progress, well, we're in the business of reviewing the evidence. I'm not going to go into detail there, you can read it in this slide, but I want to get this slide up in the next two or three. So what we're trying to do now, and some of you may have views on these things, we're trying then to decide what can we look at. These are the four areas where we think, we've got that box up there, for each of these intervention areas, there's already evidence on both effectiveness and cost. It might not be the most brilliant evidence in every case, but there's actually something there. So they're definitely in a sense, we're going to include them in our study in some way and try and get some conclusions about what we think might be cost effective. And here's a bunch of stuff that's out. There's no evidence on effectiveness, and these were all, as far as I can remember, rejected by NICE for exactly the same reason. No evidence, either they've never been evaluated or they've been evaluated and they don't work. Okay, and lots of other things like swimming dolphins, which is not on the slide either. Okay. And then there are loads that we're not sure about. And we're still in the process of sifting through the evidence. We're looking for robust, or what I call robust enough evidence on effectiveness, and then we're trying to examine the economic case. There's one lot on this slide, one lot on the next slide, so you can just quickly cast your eye down that if you want to. So a whole range of things, from very general awareness raising or tackling stigma, which has been shown to be both effective and cost effective in other areas, such as in relation to through to a whole range of more specific, for example, assistive adaptive technologies, and so on. And then some more, again, we're looking for evidence, including what I put there, standard social care services, standard educational services, for example, where we're interested in whether those standard services, when delivered to autistic people, have particular effects, whether they're effective, whether they are cost effective. So, whole range of things that we're looking at, I'm sure of things not on those slides that you would have thought of. And I'd be delighted, I'll show you my email address at the end, delighting to have suggestions for more that we could look at, and of course any evidence you think might be missed through a standard academic search. So, concluding comments, a couple of things just to finish. First of all, how is economic evidence used for what purposes? And I put a few things on the slide here, because we see this evidence, this type of evidence being used for lots of things. One is a comparison between localities or providers, perhaps for monitoring and policy. So George Osborne, not very helpfully in my view yesterday, decided to put more money into social care by letting local authorities raise it through council tax. That's going to lead to even more variation across the country in social care than we have today, and what we have today is unacceptable. So comparison between authorities, between thing, and economic evidence is an important part of that. Secondly, commissioning. Commissioners want to know not just whether something is effective, but is it cost effective as well. It's then the evidence is used if you're a provider, if you're a deliverer of services, you want to know what is the cost of what you deliver and the cost effectiveness of alternative ways of using those resources. People are trying to sell you things, whether it's a pharmaceutical company or technology equipment company. They will use economic evidence in marketing, and government will use it in market management. We see it for policy development and lobbying, so charities in the sector will use economic evidence, as they have done very well in using those big cost figures. And there are bodies like NICE who will use economic evidence as part of their guideline development. They need NICE in recommending to the health service and to social services in this case, would be wanting to say not just this is effective, but also there is an economic case, it is worth it in some way. So what do we need to do next? And I just put up here, but I think we don't need to keep calculating the overall cost of autism. Okay, it's helpful to grab attention. Whenever we've done this in about four areas now, dementia and schizophrenia and autism come to mind. My mum loves it, so I'm on telly usually with those things. But scientifically it's wasted. It doesn't help decision making at all, it just grabs attention. So they're not particularly helpful pieces of research. We don't necessarily know the total cost of everything, but we do need to know what how costs will change when we change the system in some way, so there's incremental differences. We certainly do need economic evaluations, because we need to know whether spending money in this way compared to this other way is worth it in some sense. And we need to understand the value generated of those interventions. I don't mean value where we're going to put a pound sign on that value, but some understanding of what those interventions will be delivering in outcome terms. And then finally, cost-effective analyses focus on this trade-off between outcomes and costs. And in that way, I think they very helpfully force us to confront what we as a society implicitly usually attach by way of value to the health and well-being gains for autistic people in this case. So I think that's what I would see our agenda to be. Whoever stands up here in 10 years' time talking about the economics of autism, I hope they have much more evidence to use than I've been able to use today, because we haven't got very much yet and we need to do some of this. Thank you. So email me if you